As the second key scenario, we have a look at the double-slit experiment. We assume that this experiment is carried out not with a wave, but with a source of particles. So a source emitting particles, which then are sent through a screen containing two slits. We are going to collect the particles on another screen that is positioned behind. Now, the particles that we want to carry out this experiment with, we are going to assume are fundamental particles in the following sense: that they do not contain any internal features by which we could distinguish which of the two slits they have been passing through. So this could be, for instance, electrons, but it also applies well to protons, even though you could think of protons being composed particles, for instance, of quarks, or atoms, which actually also have internal degrees of freedom and states, but these we still have to develop, or even larger molecules, but not too large so that they do not start to vibrate in a certain way, depending on which of the two slits they have been passing through, for instance, or even leave some sort of marker on the screen. So if these conditions are fulfilled, the experiment will give you the following result. The particles are going to move through the screen. Let's look at one individual particle here, and it will appear at a certain position, say at this one here. Now let's look at the next particle going through. Now, I do not really want to indicate which of the two slits these particles are going through, even though the sketch might almost suggest which of the two slits it might have been. But given our assumptions, we cannot really tell. But what we can see is that if we carry this out with the next particle, it will arrive at a different position. Now, does this mean it has gone through the other slit? Well, let's see, if you carry this out now with other particles and continue with many particles, you actually find a relatively random sequence of different positions occurring all over the place. Certainly not just, for instance, in the images of the two slits on the screen. As a matter of fact, when we wait for long enough and then make a sort of histogram, collect basically the density of the points on this axis here, we find a pattern that very much looks like the diffraction pattern of a wave. So in particular, we find many particles arriving close to the middle of the screen, which is really in the shadow of the slits. So there are two key observations at this point: the probabilistic arrival of the particles on the screen, and the fact that we observe a diffraction pattern. Now, if we were dealing with a wave, the diffraction pattern here would map out the intensity of the wave, and say here the intensity along the x direction. But what we see is that in this experiment, this does not really represent an intensity. The most natural interpretation of this function is that of a probability, or a probability density. Now, if we want to determine the intensity of a wave, then we usually start with the amplitude of the wave and basically take the absolute value squared. The amplitude in quantum mechanics will be denoted generally as a symbol psi. So therefore, the intensity of this wave would be psi squared. But instead of interpreting it as an intensity, we should interpret it as a probability density. So there are a couple of key questions at this point. The first one is how we should calculate or determine this so-called wave function psi. And the second one is, in which way exactly does this tell us something about the general properties of the particle? For instance, given that this is a function of position only, how does this determine other properties of the particle, such as its momentum? In order to make some progress, we need to determine the correct wave equation, which is known as the Schrödinger equation. Now, in order to achieve this, we have a look at some mathematical features of plane waves, which we then can generalize. Once we have the Schrödinger equation, we can then look at some further examples to develop a consistent set of rules that apply to all systems.